Okay, good evening everyone. Actually, there's still 5 minutes left for the session to begin. But thank you very much for joining in. We have an interesting topic today. And we're just doing the logistics right now, just checking the audio and all. So I think we can start. It's almost 5 o'clock. So good evening, everyone. My name is Mopia Basu, and I am very thankful to all of you for joining me in this session today. And I am very thankful to SGR Knowledge Foundation for inviting me for this talk today. Today's topic is a very interesting topic. Though, ironically, most people find the subject boring. So I am going to today tell you why the subject of history can be very interesting, and it can be made interesting actually. So our topic today is historical fiction going beyond the books. Now let me tell you at the outset that I am not a historian. I am a literature student, but history fascinates me. And there is a reason for that. History fascinates me because history is about stories. His story. It is literally about stories. The story of man, the story of man's deeds. You know, like we have the Iliad, we have the Odyssey, we have our own epics, the Mahabharata, the Ramayana. So what are these all about? Essentially, they are the stories of men and their deeds from an era which was long ago. So history fascinates me because it helps me connect with a period, with an era. It transports me to that period where there were people like you and I who lived, but you know, we spoke different languages, they spoke different languages, they had different cuisines, they dressed differently, they had different forms of government, very different from what we have. So I think you know, though they were also, you know, men and women like us, I wanted to know why, and how different were they? Were they really different? Because essentially human beings are the same through the ages. So what was it different then? How was it different then, and how is it different now? And then we come to our history textbooks, and history is a subject in school. And we are asked to read history, and we are told, mug up these dates, such and such event happened on such and such day, and these were the dynasties and these were the rulers. And we just go through the entire drill without understanding, without being interested. Most of us fell asleep in class, which is extremely unfortunate, because history is the shared knowledge of our past. And even what we were taught in, you know, in our textbooks, was again very limited. A student sitting in northern India, just about, if at all, just about, had a very sketchy idea about the history of southern India, or a student in Gujarat would hardly know about the stories and the history of northeast India. So, not only was history in our textbooks limited to certain regions and certain dynasties, of course the vernacular, the regional histories were there, but again, those again were limited to their particular regions. But history is, history of a nation is something that binds, that connects every person in that country from north to south, east to west. It is a common shared heritage, a common legacy. So how to connect people from across the length and the breadth of the country, you know, with our past, because the past is, you know, something that not only is something we have inherited, but it also teaches us the lessons for the future. And most importantly, it gives the voice to those millions of people who have never been heard. Because the history that we read in schools is primarily history that has been written by official chroniclers, mostly commissioned by either the regional the administration during that time, or the rulers, the kings about, you know, the history was written, the official chronicles, the hagiographies of dynasties were written as they wanted us to know, right? So was that really an authentic picture? Was that really a clear picture? Was that really an unbiased picture? A complete picture? No. They told us what we should know. And it has happened across centuries and millenniums. Okay. And as I've said earlier again and again, history is not limited to a particular region. History of a nation is not limited to a particular region. It is not limited to just a particular dynasty or, you know, a particular language. It is a shared past. Okay, so now, today we are going to talk about how do we get to know of this past. You know, history in textbooks, what we have learned is, I feel we have lost the sense of personal, you know, the vivid personal sense of engagement with each other, with our history, with the past that existed in, you know, in oral cultures where history was told as a story. That's the essential difference. Now, oral cultures, again, a lot of historians, academics may feel that, you know, history told through different forms of art and the official history, documented history, are, you know, they're polarized completely. But not so really, because essentially history is, again, the story of recorded by man and the story of man. So it is not really polarized, it is not really different, it's just how you narrate it and a completely total holistic view of our history. So I will here talk about how history can be made more interesting, more engaging, and more unbiased through different forms of different mediums, different media, different forms of engagement, and make it more, you know, interesting. Because after all, it is all about storytelling. History is about storytelling. So, it, you know, I'll give you an example. For instance, as a child, when I was growing up, over the dining table, my father used to narrate stories of his childhood. Now, all these I collected in a book called Khoka for young adults. Now, he grew up in what is today Jharkhand, that is Giridih. That time, that was part of Bihar, that time in Giridih, while our ancestors belonged to Dhaka. Now, Dhaka that time was, you know, again a part of undivided India. And there was constant, you know, exchanges between East Bengal and West Bengal. And my father then moved to Jharkhand. He grew up in the jungles of Giridih, in the towns of Giridih. Now, he used to tell me about these stories. That, you know, how he used to go on a steamer from, Calcutta to Dhaka, okay, to meet his grandfather, and across a two-storied steamer across the river Padma. Now, Padma was a huge river that time. Now, I am sitting in Delhi. Okay, I have not read about this in my history book, about the fact that steamers used to ferry from, you know, not just people, but also cargo, a lot of cargo, a lot of, you know, trade used to take place between Dhaka and Kolkata. The jute mills were there. So a lot of, you know, bales of jute used to be transported across the river Padma. And how once, as he was traveling, he was a little boy that time, and the steamer ran aground. And then he told me that on the top deck, the Britishers used to sit. Okay, and on the lower deck, it was the Indians, the natives used to sit. And for the British, there was separate food made. And once the ship, the steamer, ran aground, all the class discrimination, everything went for a toss. And the Britishers came down, and how together, you know, in the face of calamity, they all came together, and finally they eventually reached Narayanganj. Now, Narayanganj, my ancestral village. Now, these stories, or the fact that that very esteemed scientist, our scientist, most beloved scientist, Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose, he came and died in Giridih. Now, vaguely, if you read in your history book, you will say, yes, you know, you might read, Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose died in Giridih. But because he told me this story, I started reading up more about Jagadish Chandra Bose. He told me that an entire train had been, organized by the government of India to bring those people who wanted to pay their last respects to this very, renowned scientist who came to the small town of Giridih to die. And it was then that I read up more about him and I realized that he was the one who actually, you can call him the father of wireless, not really Marconi as we are told, but the West did not want to acknowledge the contribution of an Indian. And it was very late, sometime in 1937, I think, when he got the fellowship for the Royal Society of I think just a year before he died. So these stories, I have not read in my history textbooks. So we begin right from the family stories. My husband tells me that, his father had told him about, in 1942, when Bengal was in the midst of this huge famine. Now, we have read Bengal famine 1942, end of story. But what was the common man going through? What was the common man suffering from? He said that at that time, his grandfather was the district magistrate. So his two daughters, or his daughter, one of his daughters and her friend, were invited to the British officers' mess there in that local area for dinner. And when my husband's aunt went there, what does she see? She was appalled at the spread that was laid out. While you come outside the mess and there are people dying on the roads and starving. Millions of Indians. And look at the British mess, stocked with food, piles of food, they're entertaining, And she just couldn't handle it. I have grown up listening to my mom tell me about the 1947, riots. She was in Delhi, she was growing up in Delhi. It was an area in Delhi which was fairly populated, almost equally populated by Hindus and Muslims, and how every once in a while somebody would come rushing and ask after someone. It could be a Hindu, it could be a Muslim, and they would then thereafter go and kill them. And then they ran out of rations, my mother's family. My grandfather was a doctor. So they used to have tins of powdered eggs, egg powder and milk powder, and they sustained on that for months. There was no food. So these are the little things. My brother-in-law has a small diary in which, my husband's grandfather has recorded the exact moment when our country gained independence. So we have to first start from our family history. Every family, especially in India, which goes back to so many thousands of years of civilization, we have proper family lineages. So if when we hear these stories told to us by our grandparents, our uncles and aunts, and our teachers, and our parents, we get to know of those aspects of history which we would have never known. And that is very important, because history is also the story of the common man. Okay, history is the story of emotion. It is the story of, all kinds of feelings. It is the story of society, and society comprises of the common man. Okay, so now, earlier, what used to happen was, there was an oral tradition, the ballads, for instance. Now, there is a very famous ballad on called Desingu Rasa Kathai in Tamil. Now, this was a ballad on which was also based a film called Raja Desingu, and in which the hero was MGR. Now, who was Raja Desingu? Have I read about him? No. But there is this fort, one of the few forts which remain in Tamil Nadu today, is the fort of Chinji. And Raja Desingu was the king of Chinji. And how he engaged with the Mughal forces and all that was narrated through a ballad first. And then came the film. So the bards actually did the job of connecting people from different parts, because they traveled. They used to go yahan se wahan, upar se niche, left to right, east to west, used to travel. They used to perform at certain occasions, banquets. They used to go to inns and they used to sing. We have our bowl singers, for instance, who told us about our spiritual history, our religious history, our the kind of moral fabric our society comprised of, and what should our moral spiritual aspirations be. Similarly, you know, I mean, they actually, they always talked about heroes and heroines and important events in a language that the common man could understand. They sang songs, they danced, they staged plays. So this is a very, very important part, important medium through which history has been handed down to us. So, and a much more interesting way, because it is a storytelling, right? Nations that lack written histories, for instance, depend, rely completely on oral traditions. So, like in Assam, for instance, Barfu Kanar Geet is a ballad, a very famous ballad. Then you have Rangiyar Krishak Bidroho. You know, these are local important parts, local stories, important stories from our history, which were told as part of an oral tradition. So every generation could know and be interested. So what is the takeaway here? One is we get to know of these incidents, of these events. B, it has more impact on us rather than, you know, just reading A, B, C, D, okay, this happened, this happened, that, 1945 mein ye hua, 1930 mein ye hua, 1700 mein ye hua, this is the Mughal dynasty, this is the Gupta dynasty, this is the Maurya dynasty, and in south there were the Cholas and the, you know, the Pallavas and, you know, a whole assimilation of kingdoms. Then when I went to Hyderabad, for instance, I didn't know anything about the Qutubshahi dynasty. I think in my history book, barely a paragraph or so must have been there at the most. When I went there and I went to the fort, the Golconda fort, and I went and heard the Sonidium at the sound and light show there, I heard about Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah, who had fallen in love with a Hindu Devdasi, a Hindu courtesan called Bhagmati. Now, there is no mention of Bhagmati anywhere, either in our history books or in the official chronicles of the Qutubshahi dynasty. But it is believed, if you go to the streets, the lanes and bylanes of Hyderabad, you cannot but hear tales about this huge love story of, you know, Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah and Bhagmati. Bhagmati was a Devdasi, a Hindu courtesan, whom Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah, one of the most important rulers of the Qutubshahi dynasty, married and rechristened her as Hyder Mahal, after whom he built the city of Hyderabad. Okay. So we will know that, okay, Quli Qutub Shah built, you know, the Char Minar, the Makkah Masjid and the city of Hyderabad. But the real story, which actually stays with us, is when we hear the locals, the guides telling us about, you know, this absolutely epic love story. It is, Hyderabad is an ode to love. Or my second book, for instance, is on, now for instance, if you just, you know, I don't think there is anybody who has not heard this. Very few people in India may not have heard this. Singhasan hilute rajvansho ne bhukuti tani thi, bure bharat mein bhi aaye phir se nayi jawani thi. Ghumi hui azadi ki kimat sabne pehchani thi, dur firangi ko karne ki sabne man mein thani thi. Chamak uthi sansattavan mein veh talwar purani thi, bunde le har bolo ke muh humne suni kahani thi. Khoob lari mardani wo to chhansi wali rani thi. Okay, now, when you read about Rani Lakshmibai in our history textbook, 1857, the revolt of, you know, the Sepoy mutiny, Rani Lakshmibai was born, she married the king of Jhansi, she died fighting. Okay, fine. But when you hear this poem, it sort of tears you, you know, it sort of, you know, just goes right into you, and you it shakes you up, and you can actually visualize her. You can actually feel, you know, the kind of, you know, the sentiments of the people that time. Chamak uthi sansattavan mein veh talwar purani thi, bunde lo har bolo ke mo, humne suni kahani thi. You know, so the impact, the takeaway is much more, it is better absorbed. So again, I'm saying that the various mediums of history has, you know, there are so many different ways history can be narrated, and it is unfortunate that we have to just study history, just read history. Now, when it comes to, you know, okay, there is poetry, there are the oral traditions, there are the family stories, and What about theatre? My last book is a retelling of Anarkali and Saleem. Now, we all have read about the Mughals. I mean, we have read a lot about the Mughals. I mean, it's probably the most documented, one of the most documented dynasties of our history. In that we know, okay, Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, and Aurangzeb, and so on and so forth, and then the lesser Mughals, and then the last Mughals. Now here, again, in our history books, there's no mention of Anarkali. But you go to Lahore, which was part of the Indian subcontinent that time, there is an entire tomb which is considered to be Anarkali's tomb. Now, the contemporary historians that time, like Abul Fazl in his Akbarnama, Jahangir in his Jahangirnama, they did not mention Anarkali. Whereas the local tales, the folklore of Lahore is all about Anarkali and Saleem, including the inscription where Saleem, which is allegedly written by Saleem, which is signed as Saleem Majnu, son of Akbar, to his beloved. So, this was a story Taj Imtiaz Ali heard in Lahore. He was a resident of Lahore. And for years, since his childhood, he'd been hearing about this Saleem Anarkali story being told by his family members, his city, his, you know, village, whatever. And then he decided, he had read Western drama, and he said this is a perfect recipe for a tragic love story, which was the flavor of the theater scene that time, even in the West. So for the first time, the story of Saleem and Anarkali was written in 1923 by this gentleman, Taj Imtiaz Ali. Now, Noorjahan is recorded, but Anarkali is not. But ever since he wrote that, you know, that love story as for the stage, it was not well received. It was also, it sort of the British were very happy with it because it sort of it portrayed Akbar in a very poor light, and they wanted to show that, you know, we are look at the Indian kings. They are so uncivilized. They're such savages. They're entombing a live girl, you know, live woman. But we are here to civilize them. It was not well received because Akbar did, after a point, have a very good, he came to be known as a benevolent king. So then Taj Imtiaz Ali did a very smart thing. The movies had just come in, so he adapted his play for the cinema, in a cinematic format, and the first movie called Anarkali was made, I think, in 1931 or 32. Yeah, and that was a silent film, and then one in 37, and thereafter, in 1953, Filmistan Studios produced Anarkali with Beena Rai and Pradeep Kumar. Now here we come to films, and I would say that, you know, films is probably the most popular, It has star power. It is the star vehicle. Okay, it captures the audience's interest instantly. So the audiences get to know about history, not necessarily very accurate, but at least they become acquainted with history when they watch historical films. It creates a common consensual view of history. Okay, when you see Dilip Kumar and Madhubala as Anarkali and Saleem, you will forever remember that story, and you will then read up more, perhaps go back further and then start reading up and then know more about Jahangir and more about, you know, his life as an emperor, and did this actually, because the year Anarkali is supposed to have died as per the play, in the year 1599, is also the year when Akbar shifted his capital from Lahore to Agra, known as Akbarabad that time. So, film is perhaps the most powerful media from which to learn, one of the most powerful media from which to learn history, and it offers often the only way people know about it. Now, for instance, I, for the first time, heard about the Sanyasi rebellion in Bengal in the late 18th century through the film Anandamath. Anandamath was based on a book, novel written by Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, in which the term Vande Mataram was the war cry. That was the first time it was used in Anandamath. So, how did I get to know about it? I've not read about the Sanyasi rebellion in my history textbook. It was only when I watched the film Anandamath, and then I learned that Anandamath is based on this epic novel of Bankim Chandra Chatterjee's called Anandamath, that I learned about it, and I learned about this huge uprising at that time. Now again, you know, there are different interpretations of history through different kinds of media, different kinds of perspectives. For instance, I live in Maharashtra, in India, and here Marathas are the heroes, the warriors. You go to Calcutta, you go to Bengal, you will find them as the marauders there. There's the famous Maratha ditch there, and as per folklore, you know, the mothers used to actually scare the kids and say, go to bed or the Marathas will come. You know, similarly, those who are heroes here or there may not be viewed as the same from the same perspective as the other side. So that is, these are the things that's captured through other mediums. Okay, now when Ramayana and Mahabharata was first telecast on Doordarshan in the late 1980s, it sort of broke records. Unprecedented scale, people watched it. I mean, nobody had watched Doordarshan so much probably. And it was, it had such a massive impact on the people because it presented ideas of, you know, firstly, it connected that generation of people with, you know, a part of our mythological, our culture that they were not really aware of. And this served very well the purpose of Hindu nationalism. They sort of leveraged this because post-colonial, you know, post-independence, there were just about, I think, two and a half to three decades had just passed. So it was, this whole post-colonial nation, the stories were all displaced by mythological, origins of India as Bharat. Okay, so it had a huge impact on the audiences. Now, when I'm talking of Anandamath, and I'm talking of, Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, around that time, there was also, he was part of the Bengal Renaissance movement. Another person who was a very important part of the Bengal Renaissance movement was Michael Madhusudan Dutt. Now, my husband went to watch a play called Michael, in which Utpal Dutt, the veteran actor Utpal Dutt, acted as Michael Madhusudan Dutt. Now, he says that despite coming from a Bengali family, that was for the first time he really learned about the importance, the life of this great person called Michael Madhusudan Dutt. And the play was multilingual. So it was in Bangla, it was in English, and partly in French. And he says that was the first time I realized that Michael Madhusudan Dutt, not only was he fluent in French, but so was Utpal Dutt. So, you know, his initiation into Michael Madhusudan's life, Michael Madhusudan Dutt's life, was through that play Michael. So there are various such examples that people from our generation today, or across the ages, have learned much more about history from different kinds of mediums than just, from our textbooks. Now, for instance, when we talk of films, films like, I'm talking mainly of Hindi films right now, say Shatranj Ke Khiladi. Shatranj Ke Khiladi is written by Munshi Premchand as Shatranj Ke Khiladi. In Urdu, it was written as Shatranj Ki Bazi. It is about two Muslim noblemen who are so engrossed in the, in the Shatranj Ki Khel, in the game of chess, that they are unaware about the political events that are happening around them. And, that Awadh has been taken over by the British. So it is a metaphor, actually. These two gentlemen, their obsession with the game of chess is a metaphor for the complete, political situation at that time, that, you know, like Wajid Ali Shah was too engrossed in his dances and in his plays and theatre, and he's written some fantastic verses himself, that the British came and took over Awadh. He literally handed it over. Now, this is where we come to historical fiction. Historical fiction. Now, that is another very, very important source of learning history. Again, historical fiction is different from what is documented. Documented history. Okay. Now, there are two kinds of literature. One is historical fiction. One is historical narrative non-fiction, which adheres more to the to facts. Okay, fiction, you have the creative liberty, thora idhar, thora udhar, you know, you enhance the characters, you add a little, subtract a little, so you sort of you know, dramatize for dramatic effect. You dramatize them, you give them a voice with the premise. The premise is, of course, the historical period of that time. But through the characters in the history books, in the historical fiction, in your story, you bring alive that period. Because when is it that you can actually feel, you can actually know about how people talked, or how people, what people wore, the dialogues, the, you know, the food they ate, or the jewelry they wore, you know, all these kinds of things. How do you know? You will know only when you see it for yourself, when you watch it for yourself, when you hear them speaking that dialect. So, some movies have been listed as very good historical dramas. Again, I'm talking of our Hindi cinema. Like, for instance, Hakikat. Hakikat portrays the Indo-Sino War of 1962. Then the Legend of Bhagat Singh, for instance. Then even to a certain extent, Lagan. Okay, so these are movies which actually are helpful for the present generation. Because Lagan gives a dramatized version of what the Indian peasants were suffering because of the taxation, high taxation by the levied by the British at that time on the Indian peasants and the Indian people. So Mughlaiyazam, again, Mughlaiyazam the film, as we just talked about. But one of my favorite adaptation, cinematic adaptation of, again, a historical fiction is Tamas. Tamas, which was written by Bhisham Sahni. Tamas means darkness. Written by Bhisham Sahni on, it was a plight of the emigrant Sikhs and Hindu families after partition, during partition. And it became a very controversial book. It was banned. And then Govind Nehlani, I'm not too sure if it was banned, but it did create a lot of, controversy at that time. And Govind Nehlani, who was himself, a migrant, he happened to just stumble upon this book in one of the bookshops, and he decided to make a film for television. I think it was a 6 or 8 episode film on television. That was when I watched it. And that was when I got to know of this, you know, I got an insight into the plight of the common Sikhs and Hindus at that time during partition, you know, what happened. It's movies like this, it's books like this, stage dramas, music, ballads, oral tradition, what the guides tell you, even the guides, the local guides tell you when you go to, you know, see the historical monuments, please don't ignore it. 60% may be his fabrication, his story, but at least 40% is based on some history. At least it'll acquaint you with that period, you know, and it'll give an idea about, you know, okay, so this was the ruler, this is what happened, and those little tidbits, like for instance, when I watched the Sound and Light Show, which is again a government-sponsored program in every historical monument in India, the Sonny Lumen Show at Golconda Fort, that was the first time I learned of the love story of Bhagmati and Kuli Qutub Shah, and how it crossed the river Musi at that time on a very rainy night, and how his father built a bridge. Now, bridge is there, but the bridge actually was built for this purpose or not, we don't know. But you know, the story is such. So then I especially went to see the bridge. It's called the Purana Pool. So then you know, when I went into the lanes and bylanes of Hyderabad, there's a Chudi Bazaar, there's a Lord Bazaar, and I saw the Makkah Masjid, and I saw the Unani Hospital, and I saw the Char Minar, and I started reading up about the Qutub Shah, is about Quli Qutub Shah, and I still get goosebumps, you know, when I look at those forts and fortresses, you know. So what I'm trying to talk about is that history is the story of man. It is the story of the common man and woman. It gives, you know, it is the story of man recorded by man. So it is imperative that we learn history from as many sources as possible, because we need to know that history. So do not ignore the diaries, your family diaries, you know. So many fantastic books have come up based on stories, family stories, interesting family stories, you know. We get to know a special dish was made, you know, this used to be the kind of condition of, you know, social conditions at that time, the political conditions at that time. So history is very, very interesting. History is not boring. It is just the way history is taught. So, you know, drama, for instance, the first Indian historical drama in English was written by D.N. Wadia, and it was called The Indian Heroine, which brings alive some incidents of the Sepoy Mutiny of 1857. Now, for instance, I did not know that, you know, Mrinalini Sarabhai, the wife of the famous scientist Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, she was a poet and a playwright, you know, of great merit. And she has written this verse play called Captive Soil in 1945, which is on the freedom movement. This, you know, these kind of plays which were written in English were slowly being received and read by a very new generation of Indians who understood and spoke in the English language, and they were being acquainted with their history, with our history, through a medium, through a language which they were familiar with, you know. So, and it kind of brought together people from different regions. English was, well, it is the kind of a lingua franca of our country. So this new generation of Indians, like us, like me, for instance, my generation, we were familiar with the English language, and we started going beyond our books by reading stuff that was being written in English, which gave us more access to our history. Okay, so like, because I've grown up in Delhi, I'm sorry, and unfortunately, I can't read the Bengali language very well. I can read it, but I'm not very fluent in it. I know I can read Hindi very well. I can read English very well. So for a person like me, you know, a Prabashi Bangali, and there are so many of us like this who live in different hometowns, you know, in different towns other than their hometowns or other than the place of origin. They had access to their regional histories, to their nation's histories, through the English language. So this was a very important thing. A lot of our playwrights, for instance, Asif Karimboy, he's one of the top playwrights of our country, and unfortunately died very early. So in a very short span, he wrote some fantastic plays. For instance, Inqilab. Inqilab was a play that he wrote based on the Najjal movement of Bengal. Okay, The Refugee, which he wrote in 1971, which was the political upheaval of East Bengal at that time. Okay, so, Harindranath Chattopadhyay has written a play on Siddhartha, the man of peace, on Gautama Buddha's life. So they were all being written in English. So a new generation was getting access to our history, our historical past, our historical figures, through a language they were comfortable with. And, I'll tell you about, there was a lot of, in Bengal, for instance, this kind of stuff, has always been written in the regional languages in Bengal, and like I said, in Tamil and on all our different languages. But this was the first time that there was a common language which, you know, helped the new generation of Indians to have access to the past in a more interesting and a more, friendly fashion, in a more intimate fashion, intimate manner. You know, the connection was far more, the absorption was far more, the receptiveness of the reader or the person who watched the films was much more, and the connect with the past became deeper, because here we had begun to understand and the curiosity came up. So these different mediums helped in rekindling an interest in history. This is the role that these different mediums play in in talking about our history. So it is very important that we go beyond the books and do not ignore other forms of art where we get to experience a slice of our history. Earlier, like for instance, Gurcharan Das's Larin Sahib, which was written in 1970. It is the history of, based in a particular period in Punjab in 1846-47, just after Ranjit Singh died and his son took over. It is a story of, Henry Lawrence, who was a resident of East India Company that time. You get an idea through that play about the history of Punjab at that time. And of course, then we have the folk tales of Sassi Punno, and we have Soni Mahiwal, So if you look at it, you'll say, oh, it's just a love story. But, the love story also reflects the milieu, the background. Why are the tragic love stories that time? Because of certain social conditions, social customs prevailing at that time, which did not allow certain, communities to get together. So, whether it's historical fiction, whether it is ballads, whether it is oral, oral tales, whether it is music, whether it is films, whether it is stage plays, puppetry, there are various kinds of mediums through which history can be enjoyed, and history can be told as a story, because eventually, only when you tell a story, only when you engage the audience, can you really get your message through. Just documenting facts. We have piles and piles of research. I don't have the time to sit. I may be very interested in history, but even then, I will not sit and go through those piles of research. No, thank you. But if someone tells me, you read this book, it gives a very nice idea about English history. For instance, my first novel, the first novel ever that I read was at the age of 13. And a lot of my friends who are probably watching now would know, it was called Forever Amber. Forever Amber actually, much before I did English literature, Forever Amber actually initiated me into the history of, into British history for the first time. For the first time, at the age of 13, I got to know of the 17th century England, London that time, the Great Fire, the plague, for instance. That period of history came alive through Forever Amber, the book. And I have never forgotten that part of history, because I read it as a story. Because the protagonists, the characters of that story were people I felt were real, people like you and I, people who spoke, there were dialogues, there were people who interacted with each other. The reign of Charles II, I will never forget the events of the incidents that happened, the important historical events of England at that time, that particular period, or Gone with the Wind, for instance. So these are, of course, I'm now basically talking about Indian history, but similarly, we have our various kinds of literature in different regions of India in vernacular languages, but it is very important that there is some common form of art which binds people from all parts of our country and acquaints us with the histories of all the regions of our country, all matching all the dots. It's not just I am from Delhi, so I will know only about Delhi, or I am from Tamil Nadu, or I am from Maharashtra, or I am from Punjab, or I am from Orissa, so only I will know only about my state. No, India is not just Orissa or Tamil Nadu or Bengal or Maharashtra. India is the whole country. You jolly well know the history of the whole country. And how will you know that? It's a shared past. How will you know that? You will know that only if it's made interesting, if it's told to you as a story. So, I mean, that is all I can say, that, you know, the impact of various other mediums of art is much more if you really want to talk about history. That doesn't mean that you don't go back to the facts. Eventually, you must check what art does, what these different kinds of medium, you know, from which you know about history does. The role they play is acquaint you with it. They kindle, you know, that spark in you, that spark of curiosity in you, after which you can go back to all those documents, all those, you know, thousands of years of research, and then find out the real facts. Though most of these, also these you know, forms of art, forms of history telling, retelling history, are not very far removed from facts. Like I was telling you about the Tamil ruler. You know, I find it a little difficult to pronounce his name. Desingu Razakathai. Desingu Razakathai, the ballad, is apparently quite different from the real history. Okay, but at least a boy or a girl from that region would know that such a king existed and he fought against the Mughals, and, you know, a part of that history, that there's this Jinji fort there, you know, which, I mean, he was a king there. So that is not taught to us in a history book. The history books will give us facts, correct facts. Okay, based on the recorded information at that time, contemporary record information, which again can be biased, right? Because that record information, it's all by man. There was no machine to record this information. There were travelers, there were, you know, artists who drew pictures and who wrote. But what we are reading in our history textbooks are basically records, official records, official chronicles of whatever is available, you know. So that would be boring. So these different mediums, going beyond the history book, going beyond our history curriculum in schools, is what, you know, will really bring alive our historical past, our common shared, it's knowledge of a shared past, you know. So I think, like, for instance, I'll give you this one little example. When I went to Assam, I visited this island called Majuli. Now, Majuli, in our history textbook, I actually really don't remember any mention of Majuli. Maybe Majuli was briefly mentioned as the biggest riverine island in the world, I think. Yes, in the world, on the river Brahmaputra. But what is the history of Majuli? Then in the newspapers, there were reports of Sanjay Ghosh, that social activist who was killed by the extremists that time in Northeast. But when I went to Majuli Island, you know, the Oriati Monastery, I still remember the name, I think it was Oriati, this was almost 12 years ago. The monks there told us the entire story. You know, he told us the story of that, the history of the island of Majuli, which was the hub, along with extremism at that time, of the Vaishnavite sect. I had no idea that these monasteries were, you know, Vaishnav monasteries, and it was the biggest, one of the biggest hubs of Vaishnavite. Vaishnavite sect was very active there and was, you know, promoted. I mean, you know, Majuli was the center for it. I didn't know about that part of our history at all. You know, so that is also very important. Travel is, of course, very important. So you get to know of, I remember way back, you know, in the 80s, there was this series titled Lohit Kinare by, I think it was produced by Bhupen Hazarika, about, I'm not too sure, but his songs and the stories of Lohit Kinare, they actually helped me know more about the history of Assam than anything that I've read in my history book, right? So Lohit Kinare, I remember, were very, very lovely, you know, short stories based on the river, on these, you know, along the river Lohit. So about the villages there, and about the culture there, about the times there, you know. So that is the kind of medium through which I would like to know my the stories from my past, the stories from history, because that is something I will take away. That is something that is absorbed and will linger rather than just learning a historical dateline. So I think it is almost time to end. And well, I have nothing more to say. Of course, I have lots to say. But I would just say that in the future, do not ignore your family histories. And you also must, we all must start recording, you know, just keep a diary or encourage our children or the younger lot, you know, all of you. We must record important events in our family because it is not just the story of our family alone. It is also the story of our communities, our times, this era that we are living in, our milieu, you know. So it is very important that we capture all that for the future generations so that they are not limited to reading history from just the history books, because then they will not read it. Then they will say, no, I'm going to sleep during this period. My teacher will come in and, oh, history, no, thank you. But then how do we carry forward our heritage if not through history, historical tales? So part of it is a little fiction, part of it is a little imagination, part of it is a little dramatization, but the premise is the same. The premise is a very rich history. So thank you so much, and have a nice evening, and thank you know,